Let's get started. Sorry for a little late. This was it would be more talk than a tutorial, but I'll try to explain things a bit more in detail than a normal talk. And first of all, yeah, I'll give you an experimental view of ghost imaging and how it works. This was a technique that initially was performed with entangled photons. You might or might not know, entangled photons are correlated photons generated in a single event, single quantum event. So in this case, we got a laser shining on a crystal, and with some probability, typically, these laser photons can decay into two photons of alpha energy. And those two photons may have a degree of correlation, and sometimes, in this case, they had they have an opposite polarization traveling in the same direction. So then they send these two photons, so here you've got two photons of opposite polarization. They send this to a polarizing beam splitter and divide these two photons into arms. Okay? Now, in this case, because the photons are always generated in pairs, you know that if you have a ping in one detector, you should have a ping in the second detector. Okay, so that's exactly what they did there. So they put an imaging system, but without an imaging detector here, on what they call the signal arm. And then they scanned a fiber across on the other arm. And the sample was an aperture stencil with four letters in it here, right in front of the collection of the bucket detector there. So what they did is just a coincidence count. So they correlated the coincidence in there. So they gave it the detector, considering the fact that this arm here is always collecting photons. So in this case, if you have a photon in one detector and a detection that is in coincidence, the other detector will know that two events are correlated. If you don't, so you know that something is missing. So that's how they built the image. So the sample was in this arm, and the sort of imaging system, in this case was just a scanning fiber, really, was in the other arm. And so by calculating this correlation all the time, they made this the image, indirectly the image of the sample. Now, eventually, people understood that this is not necessarily a quantum effect. In our modern terminology, we call this one a packet detector, this one a pixel, a ray detector, a camera. Anyway, so people realize that you don't need entangled photon necessarily to do this experiment. You need correlated beams. And these correlated beams can be of any nature. In fact, the first way that they show, people show that you can know a ghost imaging with normal classical light is by taking a diffuser, generating speckles from a laser, beam splitting them. In one case, you measure the speckles with a camera up here. Then you have an object in the other arm, and you have a bucket detector and correlated detector. You repeat this thing many times, changing the speckles that illuminate the sample. So these are the MJ functions that David was talking about before. Here. Now, eventually, people in the laser community realized that if you actually know the speckle pattern that goes on your sample, you don't even need to measure it. So you can get rid of the camera altogether. In this case, you know, you can use special light modulators to produce known pattern every time. So the only thing you have to do is correlate your bucket signal with the known pattern that you know you send it through the special light modulator. So you can get rid of the camera altogether. I will talk a bit later what you can do with ghost imaging. But let's go with this game. So what we want is a speckle field. We want to divide a speckle field in two arms. We need to measure one. At the moment, we don't have an X-ray special light modulator, so we need to measure one. This will be a reference, because it's a reference image, okay? And the subscript R is reference. Then we have a bucket detector on the other arm, and the sample is in there. So what we want to measure is the transmission function the attenuation cultures of this defect, of the same. Oops. So we call B the packet signal, and this is a slightly modified version of this David's formula. So what we take, we do, we calculate this this ensemble average. So this is the packet signal. We take the weight, the average, we multiply by the reference image, and then we average the whole. So this is, in fact, this is sort of a projection where this function here are the bits and these are the coefficients of the expansion. Okay, so this is a calculation here, not a measurement. But as you'll see, if you do this many times, slowly, you'll see that the ghost is appearing from the clouds. Okay, so this is sort of, it's inefficient. I will discuss this a little later, how you can make it a bit more efficient. We did this experiment last year, or almost 2 years ago in 2019. I wasn't actually expecting that we got such a big splash, but apparently we did. So, I mean, I've read all sorts of things about this ghost imaging stuff. My university even said that this new technique is going to make X-ray safer, and they put these broken bones in there. But anyway, so that was quite a splash. And so everybody was happy. Okay, so how we did our X-ray ghost imaging experiment? So the recipe is, we need a few things. We need the speckles, and we need to measure it. So we did the speckles by taking individual electron bands. So an individual electron bunch traveling into an enunciator will emit just noise, pretty much, amplified to some extent. And so this will be, in general, if you can measure it, a speckled pulse of X-rays in both energy and space. Well, that's an example of X-ray here, but I think it's similar physics. Okay, then we need to correlate those two bunches. So if you go to speckle, if we're able to actually split the beam in two, then we can build Henry-Brown twist-like correlators in which you correlate with densities. So this is the basic building block of why this correlation works. So the two beams will be correlated if the sample is not there in general. We split the beam, so we need a crystal to do that. So we need a thin silicon plate to do that. And we just focused on one of the spots that we managed to put on the camera. And obviously, to make sure that we measure exactly this backward pattern, we can't average over many bunches, so we need to select a single bunch at most, or a few, or a little number of bunches. So we need a fast camera. Now, we ended up having to couple this fast camera to an image intensifier because we didn't have enough flux in a single bunch. So that's how the experiment looked like. So that this massive thing here in the middle is the image intensifier. The camera is at the top. This is silicon crystal. The sample is not shown here, but was eventually inserted in one of the two beams. So the problem with this was that obviously we had to focus the beam intensifier, so they reduced the pixel size as much as we could. So eventually our image was really a limited number of pixels, so we could put a very simple sample in the beam. So this was an image of a frame of the camera as we detected. So this is the direct beam. There is a sample in the middle, which is a wire that's absorbing there. This is the reflection we managed to put into the detector field of view, and we use that as a reference. That's a blow-up version of that. So as you see, so we get some sort of 20 by 20 pixel image. And obviously you'll see that the diffraction in this case is non-collinear, so we got some transformation between the image and the direct beam and the refractive beam. There is some projection to take into account. So the ghost image will, in fact, be sort of deformed by this. Okay, so importantly, we put took both beams in the same camera, so we did not have to make a coincidence circuit to between two detectors. So each frame has one bunch, so we are sure that those two are actually coincident. And so we just, what we did, integrate the signal in this arm, pretend that we have a public detector there, and put it then in the formula, and get the ghost image. So of course it didn't work straight away, and so we went to look at the power spectrum of the public beam. So we acquired 20,000 images. There's the power spectrum there, so let's say there's low frequency noise and vibration, mechanical vibration, and so we want to actually get rid of all of these and select just these peaks here, which correspond to the frequency of the storage ring at which we were collecting data. So if you actually cut away all the crap and just keep the harmonic signal, then you'll see the ghost imaging appearing. So that's how the beams look like after we do this filtering. So as you can see, in fact, beams look sort of smooth, but in fact they are speckles. So you've got this little speckle that you can actually see only when you select the right frequency, which corresponds to having a single bunch in the light from a single bunch in your detector. Okay, so that's it. So once you select the right frequency, for instance this peak, and you run it through the reconstruction formula, then you get an image that looks like that. So if you select any other region around, you will just reconstruct some noise in general. So if we select this window, in fact, what does it mean? It's that the signal of the two arms are not correlated. And they are only correlated when we are sure that there is the frequency of the storage ring, which then you have the Henry Brown Lewis correlation. So outside of the peak, you reconstruct noise. Inside the peak, you reconstruct an image. It doesn't look like the original image. It looks the wire is sort of deformed and tilted. And I did not really spend any time to actually try to make it look like the original image. But the problem was exactly so we have non-planar diffraction there. But what we tried was to move the sample. So in our first experiment, sorry, I forgot to tell that, the sample was in the direct beam, actually. Then we managed to put it in the diffractive beam and do the same procedure. In this case, the diffractive beam wasn't the crystal here was a bit vibrating, so the image doesn't look as good. But you can see that it's actually an eye ghost imaging of the sample. In this case, because we reversed the beam, so the ghost imaging will appear. The image of the wire is also reversed. Much noisier. Okay. Now, when I was discussing ghost imaging with people in my university and other, I always get this sort of polite smile, and they say, "Yeah, okay. Then, so what? So now, what can we do with ghost imaging?" All right. So I try my best to answer this question. But first I would say we need a way to make ghost imaging more efficient. We cannot acquire 20,000 images to make one image. And so in this case, at least what the ghost imaging community in optics is doing is exploring other ways to make efficient use of the information. So if you consider that the patterns that we shine on the sample are a basis, and these are an orthogonal basis, for instance, let's suppose it's a Fourier pattern, then we'll need as many patterns as pixels. So if we have n by n pixels in our image, then we need n square pattern there. Okay, that's not very efficient. So how can we make this less? It appears that in most cases, imaging tend to be what is called, what they call sparse in some bases. Sparse means this. So suppose you get a black image with only one white dot, okay? And you save it. If you save it, you will get, the file size will be whatever number of pixels in this image. But now, because you know that it's all black and just there is only one bright pixel, you can just save the coordinate of the pixel and the size of the image, in fact. And you just know it. And that's taking much less space on your disk, right? So If you know something about your image, you can actually reduce the information that you need to save it. And if you treat an image as a vector like this, so you can expand this vector on a basis, like any other vector, and you might find a basis in which, you know, you will have basis function here and coefficient there, and you can find the decomposition by the number of coefficients is actually, sorry, the number of non-zero coefficients is actually small. So most of the coefficients are small, a few of them are significant. And that's what they do with compressive sampling, or compressive sampling. So in this case, this decomposition here is what is called the wavelet transform. So you take an image, take the wavelet transform, you have a number of coefficients, which are as many as the pixels in the image. But now, here for instance, in this case, they throw away something like 95-97% of the coefficients. So everything that is next to zero or below some threshold, they set it to zero. And then you do the inverse transform and you got an image that looks more or less. I mean, not exactly, of course, but, you know, just using about 3% of the information. So this is the basis of JPEG, I think, JPEG 2000 compression. So the idea would be trying to explore this for ghost imaging as well. So in this case, we need to find the right transformation, over which we don't need as many images, to reconstruct the ghost imaging of the scene. And once we've done that, I think these are a few applications that I might think of at the moment. I'm happy to listen to any other suggestions. But perhaps one interesting application is for all cases in which you cannot make images directly. So, or it's hard to make images. For instance, if you want to make hyperspectral imaging or multispectral imaging, so we got very sensitive spectral detector, we get very high resolution imaging detector, but we don't get a very high resolution imaging spectral detector yet. So, for instance, why not combining, instead of a bucket detector, put the spectrometer and get a spectrum every shot. Then you can make spectral imaging using ghost imaging. And if you think about it, this is exactly what David was talking about when discussing ghost images as a form of delocalized scanning probe. Because that's exactly what you would do with a scanning probe. You do your raster scan, a very small beam. And so you take many images anyway. Okay? So instead of having a very small beam, you can have a delocalized speckle beam and do the same thing. And in the case of a raster scanning, your basis is simply the beam itself, you know, like a Dirac delta at every pixel. While here you've got some sort of delocalized speckle. But that's the principle it's working. David mentioned that most of the photons never pass through the object. So this is true. We know that we can do ghost imaging with very little photons. Now, if this is actually giving some reduction in the total dose compared to normal imaging, it's not yet proven, but it doesn't hurt. We put it there, and we'll see if we actually trying to answer these questions. So can we actually reduce the dose with the same number of, with the same resolution? And another interesting idea that was discussed sometimes was, well, if we're actually able to deflect it, split the beam and make a very weak beam from it, then perhaps we could use this correlation technique between punches to try diffraction without distraction using a free electron image. So in this case, we need to know the beam itself, but we send the weak signal to the sample. So perhaps we can actually take many images of the same molecules instead of taking images of different molecules. But again, this is, I think, a few years in the future. So that's it for this lecture series. So on behalf of David and myself, thank you, Alexander, very much for inviting us here, for the nice time we had during the experiment, nice interaction with all of you, so thank you very much.
You probably look much more on ghost images taken with visible light than anyone else of us. just from the few images I saw so often, that the ghost images have not a very high dynamic range.